Greetings and good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to ARC's Fireside Chat. Thank you all for attending. Today's conversation will be with Secretary Ralph Diaz of the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation. So my name is Sam Lewis. I'm the Executive Director of ARC, the Anti-Recidivism Coalition. And today we'll be posing questions to Secretary Diaz concerning COVID-19 and our California correctional facilities. If you have questions, audience, please put them in the chat box. But just so you know, we may not be able to get to those questions. We received hundreds of questions via Instagram, Facebook, and email that we will be asking. Our hope is to be able to provide the public, advocates, family members with more information on what's being done to protect people that are currently in custody. And we also hope that this conversation will provide answers to questions that many of you have asked. With that said, I'd like to introduce Secretary Diaz. Thank you for being present and being willing to address questions that so many people have asked us and reached out to us. And we appreciate you taking your time to be present for this conversation.
Thank you, Sam. Thanks for the opportunity to be able to just communicate what we're doing and also just to, you know, answer the, you know, the hundreds of questions that are out there and the concern that you know, the citizens of California have. Not only that, the concerns of the employees that the Department of Corrections has for the population also. And I do want to say that, you know, this work in this COVID time is probably the most difficult time that we have seen in corrections in my memory. But, you know, again, I do want to thank you, Sam, for the opportunity. I do want to thank ARC for their support of myself and of corrections. And I know some tough questions are going to come our way, but you know, I hope the goal of this in the end is just to walk away feeling and having some confidence that we are doing all that we can and we are doing as much as we can with the resources available, and that we're working closely with the governor's office, working closely with all of the other state agencies to help us mitigate and eliminate this COVID in our institutions. And we look forward to the day when we can get back to doing the great work that we've been doing.
Thank you. Secretary Diaz, let's jump right into it. As we have a lot of questions, many feel that the California Department of Corrections was late to take action and protect lives inside the Department of Corrections, and is now behind the curve, so to speak, in taking action. And many people are upset. Can you tell us why does it seem that way, such as providing masks and sanitizing and soap and things of that nature? For people, and even more so letting people that are candidates be released in order to create social distancing inside the institutions?
So, you know, we've been dealing with COVID since our knowledge of it in corrections, probably around the beginning of March. And I know that there's different days when people, you know, believe that there should have been a readiness, not only as an agency, but also as a state, as a nation. It hasn't been something that we have really ever dealt with before. And since our first case within the department that we did get was on March the 20th, even before that, we did take action before we actually had a positive case. One of the most significant ones, it impacted many of you on this call. It impacted, you know, the rehabilitative process. We shut everything down. We didn't allow people to come in, we didn't allow visitors, we didn't allow volunteers. We reduced the amount of individuals who needed to come into the institutions to include the workforce to minimize the introduction. Now, you know, as COVID developed and our knowledge of COVID, and we're still learning about it, how the transmission and how it's passed on and what the vector sections are with COVID, we're learning that even today. So everything from, you know, stopping transfers to the masks, requiring staff and all inmates to wear masks, tooling up with our sanitation in our institutions, coupled with getting, you know, hand sanitizer. I mean, some of the basic things that all of us are accustomed to, hand sanitizer in the institutions, alcohol-based, did not exist pre-COVID for inmate usage. It was really just PIA soap or soap that individuals bought from the canteen or got sent in from packages. You know, but I would say that, you know, our response, although not what we would like or what, you know, what would be perceived as not being responsive enough, we have been making decisions on a daily basis and sometimes even amending those decisions that we made in the morning into the evening on how we're going to approach this, how we're going to reduce the transmission of COVID And all of it was things like putting masks on every employee and inmates. But I think many of you, if we're honest with each other, in early March and in April, the availability of these masks for, you know, over 100,000 inmates, and then even, you know, to the 60 plus thousand staff members that come in and out, just availability to get those masks. Well, now PIA pitched in, and then with the help of the governor's office and California Operational Services, we were able to procure and get a good supply line going of masks. But masks are one piece. You got the masks that have to be worn. You also have the physical distancing that is very challenging in a prison. In some prisons is better than others. Cell settings are much easier to create that distancing than you would in a dorm setting. You know, so with the help from, you know, groups like ARC, I do appreciate the donations of the soap. That is greatly appreciated, and it just shows that people outside of corrections do care about what we do. And this, the soap donations that we have been receiving from your group and others, I think it just, you know, it shows others that, you know, the inmates and staff, people care. People care not only about inmates, but they care about the staff also. And it's the staff that have to effectuate and implement much of what I'm talking about. There is a mandatory mask wear directive that's gone out twice, not only from myself, from the Director of Corrections, Connie Gibson, but from the Receiver's Office. And the latest memorandum that went out again just in the past couple of weeks, reiterating that. I've toured prisons myself. I haven't as of late. The most recent one was Vacaville when I went with the governor. And masks were worn by all staff members there. And I'm well aware that sometimes just because the secretary shows up, people are going to act right. But I, you know, you can tell when people are just, you know, showing up just to, you know, just to put it on because I'm around, but it's part of the culture. So I believe we responded in a way with what was available at our disposal at the time. I wish I had the resources then that I have now. So I think, I mean, that's how I would answer that, Sam.
Thank you. And in terms of, so we get out, we communicate with about 15,000 plus people that are in custody. Family members, we get phone calls, we get collect calls, and we've received quite a bit of mail from individuals who say, and phone calls, collect phone calls, who say they don't feel safe because oftentimes, and you kind of touched on this, staff are not wearing masks or search their cells without, and when they say, they describe it as improperly, but they go in depth, without changing gloves, without wearing a mask. What are the options for incarcerated people that are concerned about this? Like, they're not saying not to search the cells. They're saying, when you search my cell, could you please have a fresh pair of gloves on and wear a mask when you come in here because I want to be safe. How do we, like, the specific question is, who is enforcing this and the compliance, and what options do they have if it's not followed?
So I think the messaging comes from here in headquarters. It starts with me, then the undersecretaries and the directors, but the enforcement has to come at the institutional level. The enforcement comes from the supervisors on the facilities themselves. But I think we would be naive, and I would be naive to say that, you know, there aren't employees out there who aren't doing what they're supposed to do. But I think that can be said of citizens of California. Here we are in the second wave I don't like to use the term lockdown because lockdown is not what we're under right now, but the governor's ordered the modification, the dimmer switch and bringing things down a little more because people are choosing not to do what would reduce the likelihood of COVID. So if it's a matter of communicating back out to the institutions that considerations and direction have to be made, that, you know, we have to be aware that inmates and the staff, the inmates are concerned about, you know, the cell searches, which I think everyone agrees should occur. But I also think they should be in a way to where considerations with, you know, a different set of gloves, different considerations have to be made. But and I think that just comes down to communication. I think the best way to communicate this is at the local level. I'm definitely going to pass on some of what I'm hearing today and some of the questions that I've received to the director. There are daily conference calls with every institution and their incident command posts. Every prison, regardless of COVID status or the number of COVID in the population, have an incident command post that they have to reach out and communicate with local public health, local officials, hospitals, regardless of COVID status, just so we can get ahead. So these types of things just have to be communicated. And I would be concerned also if I were incarcerated and someone coming into my cell and I'm taking care to take all the precautions, and then someone comes in, you know, and doesn't take those additional precautions or respect the precautions that I'm taking. So it's all in the messaging, Sam. And we'd have to just push it down. Enforcement has to come from the supervisory level at the institution and then brought up the expectations to the captain level at the institution. But in talking to all the wardens, I believe, and I wholeheartedly believe that there's not a warden out there that does not care about the mitigation of this for their population.
So questions have been asked about DJJ. So for the audience, there may be people in the audience that don't know that the Department of Juvenile Justice is exactly what it is. It's for people who were convicted of juvenile convictions. It's part of CDCR, but separate from CDCR. CDCR is an adult branch, and the Department of Juvenile Justice is the juvenile branch. And so the question is, what precautions are being taken to protect the DJJ youth? And additionally, as there are early releases for people that are in CDCR, is this also being done for the Department of Juvenile Justice? And why isn't the information about infections in DJJ available as it is with CDCR? So it's a 2-3-part question.
Okay, and if I skip a part, remind me on it. But I will say that the compliance and the requirements of masks, cohorting, of physical distancing, of isolation, of quarantine, that we are applying requiring adult institutions, we are requiring the same of DJJ. They are part of the communication and the oversight that I provide, but not only I provide, but the director of DJJ. So they fall into those same guidelines when it comes to if we identify a youth that's COVID positive, and we have had youth test positive for COVID. The same isolation and quarantine goes into that youth on how we are going to isolate them. Now, I will freely say that the resources that are assigned to DJJ are much smaller, but that doesn't mean that DJJ does not have access to the overall resources that the adults have. Because I have the Stockton facility right next to it. I have Mill Creek, I have Folsom, I have New Folsom and Old Folsom to support DJJ in their efforts. The same type of disinfecting schedules, the same type of cleanliness are required of DJJ and in DJJ. The release or addressing of the release of DJJ, there is a different mechanism that DJJ fall under. They are more tied to the courts versus and the DJJ board that exists within DJJ, which is separate, but their process is not equal to the adult side. So for me to grant early releases for DJJ like I am for the adult side, the authority isn't the same. But I can tell you the director, Dr. Heather Bolds, she is advocating and she is seeking ways that we can, either through the courts or otherwise, to address the early release of DJJ if necessary. So I have to say, a lot of discussion has been had about, and we are in court quite a bit, and we were just in court yesterday about early releases. I have to say that early release is there for the purpose of reducing the populations and institutions where we believe that there's a high risk for medical transmission to high risk populations. And that's why we focused on 8 institutions. And those 8 institutions, through the receiver's office, have identified that they're populations that we need to focus on. Now, DJJ, they're a younger group, they're a healthier group, but that doesn't mean that transmission can't be, harmful to them. But there's more capacity within that DJJ to move individuals around and provide better cohorting and separation than I would in some of our adult prisons. So DJJ isn't out of our discussions on a daily, if not weekly, basis on what we're doing with DJJ.
Thank you. And you spoke about the 8 institutions. So one of the things that have come out there, a couple of studies and some reports by medical experts, and they say the community at large, or medical experts in the community at large, say the only way to actually curb COVID-19 crisis within our prison population is by reducing that population by 50%. We know that, for instance, the people that are being released now with 6 months, a year, and with serious convictions, but non-sexual, non-violent, are being considered, but that still won't bring us down to 50%. Are there any talks about how to get us to 50% in order to save more lives?
Well, I think that's where the conversation comes in, and not to jump in the middle of our court litigation, but there isn't an overall agreement that, you know, getting to a 50% number is going to eliminate or reduce COVID. I think we have to get to a point at each institution to have our healthcare and the receiver and CDCR to say, we are at a number that we believe we can effectively immediately activate swing space in areas to isolate individuals that are COVID positive. And then you have other areas to quarantine individuals who have been around individuals who are positive. So, you know, the thought that, you know, we have to get to a magic number, there's a lot of discussion about that. And there isn't a consensus, an agreement on that. The numbers that we released from April to the releases that we're doing now, on top of what the focus releases at the eight institutions, I believe we are addressing the needs at these institutions to get these populations down, because individuals, just indiscriminate releases are things that I've read, you know, the term mass release. I would caution, you know, that term, because if we as an agency of corrections jump into the thought that we're just going to mass release people without review, without considerations for victims, without considerations for communities, without considerations for future political fallout from things like this, because there's going to be a day when people will refocus on corrections and say, what did they do? What did they do in COVID? And my main role is to address the health and safety of the staff and the inmates being the primary, because they're the ones that can't leave. But to say that we're going to mass release, we have to do it in a way that we're doing it with the respect of victims, with the respect of the communities where they're going to. And in the end, I want to be able to say that we did the right thing for our communities, the right thing for our for our prisons and our prisoners inside our institutions. Because I don't want a day that comes back to say anybody would interpret that we took advantage of a situation, just mass release, and then we have a backlash like we've seen in the 80s and 90s. That's not good for anybody. We're trying to do it in a humane, safe, and calculated way with healthcare in mind, not just the thought of, you know, releasing to a certain percentage. We have to release to a place where we believe it's safe, where we believe we're doing the right thing in collaboration with the receiver's office.
Thank you again, Secretary Diaz. There's a question in our Q&A box that's a really great question in terms of, I know that I was reading an article where the science part of the Zuckerberg Institute, I think it is, has this rapid COVID testing. Is CDCR going to implement that statewide, people in custody? I know staff are being tested, but is it possible to get this done for people statewide, especially let's say a foundation says they'll front the money or the test or whatever is necessary just to get it done?
So I'm very familiar with that rapid test. It's the Abbott rapid testing, which we do have in our institutions. We're focusing at San Quentin. I'm learning more about rapid testing, and what the rapid test, it does get you a rapid test if someone is positive. And we're pretty solid if you're positive. We're running with that, and you're gonna go into isolation. You're gonna go into to separate you so you don't spread it. But when it comes to the negatives that come back from it, and I think that's what we're all looking for, is someone negative? And if someone's negative, then I can do more things with this person. But what we're finding with that rapid testing, there is a percentage that I wouldn't be comfortable with or others are comfortable with, that would say we are going to bank that this negative test from this rapid testing, I'm going to take it as a gospel truth and run with it. What we're doing is we're going to have to recheck those negatives to double verify those. And I think you can read some of that information. It's not just, you know, something that I'm saying here. The percentage is 20 to 30% that there could be an error in that test. 20 to 30% is way too high for me to say you're negative, then I'm going to move you somewhere. And it's not just one person when you get a negative. We'll be moving groups of people that are negative. So we are utilizing. I am the receiver's office. We are keeping an eye on what is the best technology, what is the best testing, what is the best method. And right now we are online to have all staff members tested, baseline tested at all institutions. I want to say within this week, it'll all be done. And then ongoing testing. It's the same for inmates. I have a report sitting right in front of me on this next screen here on how, where are we percentage-wise for testing all institutions. Right now, as we look at the institutions, I am looking at about 20 institutions that have COVID cases anywhere from one case all the way to, you know, 1,136 at San Quentin. And every one of them is in different levels of testing. And the goal of this is to make sure that we're testing inmates. We're doing the right thing by putting them in proper isolation, making sure that healthcare is providing the necessary checks on the individuals if they are COVID. If you are COVID in an institution, you are receiving enhanced and advanced super medical checks. Everything from the screening, but then checking your oxygen rates 2 times a day for each inmate. Healthcare as a whole, you know, we see the numbers right now at 2,174 positives, but I also look at 4,392 resolved cases. And these are numbers that you're all looking at on the tracker. But I hope you're, you know, I feel, you know, one death is way too many. Every one of them is tragic, every single one. And I really appreciate a statement that you made not that long ago, Sam, and I forget which forum I've been in so many. We have had, you know, as of today, as a total, 42 deaths, 39 inmates and 3 staff. This affects everybody. And, you know, every one of those deaths is a tragedy, but it's not just in prison, it's out of prison. We've had, you know, friends and family affected by this, all of us. So for me, you know, what I look at and what I focus on is not to chase fast answers like, you know, rapid testing is the answer for everything. It's testing plus other measures. We can't rely on one. We have to rely on the distancing, the masking, the communication, the deep cleaning, the hospital response to make sure we're not overwhelming hospitals, and making sure we have sufficient staff and institutions providing the service, not only the custodial service, but also the healthcare service.
Thank you. Two questions in terms of releases. So one is mechanisms, and the other one is populations that are considered. And then I want to kind of jump back to the institutions, or maybe let's start with the institutions. So the two institutions that have been hit the hardest are San Quentin and CIM. CIM was first, and now San Quentin. Is there a science? Do we understand why are those two institutions? Why is the mortality rate so high and the infection rate so high, and what steps can actually be taken or are being taken to reduce that?
Well, I think, you know, number one, those two institutions, Chino Level 2, San Quentin Level 2, plus Condemned and Reception Center, both of them were Reception Center. We're moving away from Reception Center processing at San Quentin and at Chino. We're focusing our reception centers to only 2 locations, not only COVID, but even beyond. But at those institutions, you have a higher level of individuals that are older in age. They've done quite a bit of time. They're institutions that they have a lot of programs people seek to go to. They're program-rich locations, and I'm talking pre-COVID. Those are people that, you know, they're up in age and a lot of time, so the higher in age you get, you get a higher population with you know, morbidity factors that are more susceptible to, if you do get COVID, it's more serious. So not only that, you get dorm settings, which is majority at Chino other than your reception center and your Palm Halls and such. But then at San Quentin, you have the open bar setting, the 5-tier open bar setting, which is, you know, it's not conducive to, you know, airflows or just, you know, go through that whole unit. So I think everything from the age of the institution, the age of the population that are in those institutions, and then, you know, institutions like that are staff heavy. They're staff resourced heavy because you need more staff to run institutions like that. So you have more staff coming in. So I think you take a look at what are we doing with staff to make sure staff aren't coming in positive. Because you're right, the vector for the inmates, it did come in from staff, but I need to remind the initial cases that we've seen, they came in actually after hospital visits. So they came in contact with somebody. So not only that, the staff, you have to require them to wear masks, you have to require them to go through screening, you have to require them to go through the temperature checks, you have to require them to stay home if they're feeling sick. You have to require them to report when they do test positive. We're also mandating, and we do have testing at every institution on site. They're coming in and to get that baseline testing. But if you get tested once, you're going to have to get tested again. Just because you test negative once doesn't mean you're not going to turn positive at some time. So it's enforcing not only the custody staff, you have all kinds of staff that come into an institution, from culinary to free staff. And so all of them, you know, that's the vector for it. So I think, you know, the older institutions, that's why we picked St. Quentin. We picked Chino. We picked Vacaville. We picked RJD. We picked CCWF, CIW. I forget the two others, but of the eight, we had that population as determined by the receiver. We have to focus on staff, and we have to focus on inmates and testing.
So in those eight institutions, one of the things I know that they said were the people that were ages 65 and older. Why not 55 and older or 50? Because I know that this also, there's review of cases and everything, but so is 65 a number that they're sticking to, or are they looking at 60, maybe 55, as far as age limit?
Yeah, that's a good question, Sam. That's a number that I have to rely heavily on my partners in the receiver's office. And so if it comes from them, that's what we're going with. I'm not really debating that with them. When it comes to a lot of the medical advice and the recommendations that come from the receiver's office, which is our healthcare partners, I have to go with that. And that's where that's coming from. And, you know, we do have epidemiologists that work in CH that work for the receiver. Dr. Joe Bick, you know, is now our head doctor for the receiver's office, who is an epidemiologist. He's very familiar. If you know him, he started in Vacaville during the AIDS crisis, and he joined dealing with that head on. And so I have a lot of confidence in Dr. Joe Bick and our receiver. So that's why that age comes the way it is. So Folsom and Stockton are the other two facilities to round out the eight.
Thank you, Secretary Diaz. In terms of families being able to communicate, so visiting has been shut down now for 5 months. From what I understand, many institutions are on modified programs and access to phones are limited. And even phones, some people just can't afford to be able to make some of those phone calls. And though GTL has done some work to help people make free phone calls, is there a way, like, for instance, what if we were able to get a group of foundations or philanthropists to say, we'll donate 1,000 computers for every laptops that or desktops that can sit in every visiting room, where you could have like a Skype or Zoom 30 minutes so families can say, hey, I see you, you're okay, I love you. Not long, 8 hours, but at least 30 minutes where they can see their family members and know that they're okay.
So, you know, this is one of those subjects. When I came to headquarters, it seems like the other day, but now we're going on, you know, 6 years up in headquarters. One of the first things we did look at was the possibility of beginning video visiting, similar to what they did in Los Angeles County. There was some work that went in on that. But then there was a lot of concern that came back that we were trying to do away with physical visiting and contact visiting. And that wasn't the case. We were just trying to enhance our visiting opportunities for locations so where families couldn't get to more readily. And because of some of those concerns, we didn't fully implement that. So here we are now in a time to where it was, you know, we're in a situation where we say, we wish we could have, we would have, you know, back, you know, trying to run this in the rearview mirror, but we can't. But I'll tell you, we are seeking all opportunities in other ways so we can enhance visiting. We have pilot programs for these tablets in some institutions. And I think we have enough data to where we are seeking to go that direction statewide, but it turns into a situation to where we have to have a company provide that service, and we have to go through the competitive bidding process for this. And one of the things that I am ensuring as a secretary that whatever comes out, the cost and the services are first and foremost for me. I don't need this to be any of this to be implemented on the backs of family members to where they're paying exorbitant rates, because money is going to be made by some company out there. But even beyond that, I think society, my grandchildren, they communicate via tablet. They communicate, they know how to do it. So it's normal. So we're looking forward to when we do implement that and when the contract is up to see how we can roll this out in a way that we're as beneficial. I know DJJ has a video visiting pilot going on right now. I'm hearing good things about it. The director of corrections, Connie Gibson, just communicated with me and the other undersecretaries that she's looking for ways and institutions to leverage laptops, leverage Skype and the free things like we're doing right now, how we can do it. It's not a matter of corrections doesn't want to do it because we're heartless or because, someone's not going to make money. That's not the situation. It's a matter of doing it in a way to where it can be as equitable as possible, but yet do it in a way where we can sustain it until we get to a point to where we can have tablets in the hands of every individual. We can have tablets or kiosks, however this rolls out. I wish we had made this decision 5 years ago to go full tablet, full video visiting, and we'd be addressing something else. Because I understand it is through the family members, through the loved ones that have been communicating with their loved ones inside these institutions that have been assisting in reducing the tensions and reducing the negative behavior that does occur. And I do have to say that negative behavior in our institutions is down. It is down. Not to say nothing's happened, because we've had some homicides since COVID, but I don't count that as, we have to pump the brakes on everything. What I am saying is that loved ones and friends and family have been doing their part. You have been doing your part. The messages that ARC did on the front end, and I look forward to another one to put on our video system. But, I'll lean on you. I'll lean on those on this call. If you, if you see a way to do it, to provide, a connectivity with the population, in a way to where it's not just going to affect, CMF, X-Wing or Salinas Valley B Yard Building 5. I need to have it in a way to where, it could be equitable for everyone gets an opportunity to this. So, I'll lean on you if you have ideas.
So just so for the audience to understand, because I know we have people that are listening that know people. I even noticed that there was a couple of foundation people on this call. If this is something that we can figure out how to provide those tablets to every institution, like a thoughtful process and suggestion and a means to have the resources so that families can connect, let's reach out to me at the end of this. We'll figure it out. We can work as a collective, advocates, foundations, resources, and figuring out how to get those resources in. For instance, we do some mentoring with juvenile facilities, and we purchased the fire tablets that were like $50 per tablet. And so just an idea for advocates, for those that are listening, I think this is an opportunity was definitely to lean in and to be able to set up connectivity for our families. During COVID, and I'm looking at this right now because as the cases spike in California, it doesn't seem like we're gonna be coming out of this in the next 30 days or the next 60 days. Just my opinion, I could be wrong. I pray that I'm wrong, but during this time, if there's a way for us to get together and put this together, definitely I'm game to do whatever work we need to do. On a separate question, this has come up often, both mechanic-wise, so there's an assembly bill that was passed in 2019 called AB 965, which basically allows youthful, as they describe it, youthful offenders to earn credits towards their release or go to the board a year prior to their release. Has this been implemented? That's one mechanism, and I'll go to the second after you're able to answer that on Secretary Group Diaz.
So significant programming to existing data systems is necessary to implement this. And, we are going to have, and we are in the midst of changing and implementing regulations on this. But due to changes in the law, 261 AB 1308 Prop 57, the board is mandated to conduct hearings for determining census youth offenders and nonviolent third strikers by no later than December 31st, 2021. And combined with recent hearings postponed due to COVID, when we are transitioning from in-person hearings to video hearings, the board doesn't have the capacity right now to do the hearings in time. And I will say that the video hearings are being built up. The BPH is doing these hearings, but the DJJ also, there was a lag time just to figure out how we're gonna do hearings and is it okay to do video hearings? There's a lot of legal question when it comes to video hearings and access to people who need to be in those hearings, not only victims, but also DAs and the pre-interview with attorneys and all of that. So that's been worked through, but also per an agreement with the author of the sponsors of AB 965, we will apply educational merit credits to youth parole eligible dates beginning January 2022, and they will be retroactive applied for high school diplomas, GEDs, and college degrees previously earned during the current term. So, I mean, all that being said, there's no quick and fast response as it relates to COVID, but these are, 965 is something that DJJ is looking at, we're looking at on how we can fit this into the overall COVID response.
The second tool is alternative custody programs, ACP. As we understand, they're being labeled as transfers. Is this a mechanism that actually can be put into place? And if so, they're not transfers, they're actually releases as we understand them. Could you share with us, is this something that's being put into place to expedite more people being released under that mechanism, alternative custody program?
So the releases are being done right now under government code 8680, I've had so many things in my head. It's under the government code that's given to the secretary to place individuals in other locations that are in, that could prevent or assist in the reduction of them from being in a harmful place. But again, that comes down to, the April releases were built around, we're just expediting inmates going home within 60 days. Now we've expanded it to several different buckets. We initially believed, and we believe that, the alternative custody placement criteria would fit for everybody, but it doesn't fit for everybody because alternative custody placement requires that the location that they're going be an address and a location that is suitable for them. And now that's becoming more difficult because we have individuals that, the people that will be accepting them, they're either elderly. We've had people say no. One of the biggest challenges with this on the releasing individuals is having a location for them to go. Your group has reached out. Others have reached out. There's been a group of philanthropy that have offered housing and funding for housing. BSCC had a meeting yesterday to approve monies for this. So through parole, through DRP, and through the work of community-based organizations like yourselves and others, and some of our reentry partners, we are seeking to get this money and utilize it to open more locations to put individuals in, not only just for the sake of putting people in them, because we also have to recognize that we have to transition them into a situation to where they're going to be successful. Not just to get them out of prison. We have to set them up to be successful. And to be successful now is more challenging than it was pre-COVID because the job situation is different. The ability to move around and get to move about is different due to the COVID concerns that are there. But in the end, it's about finding that proper handoff to get them into the right place. So we are looking at, the ability to get people in an ACP situation, but we have to look even beyond that. So we reached out to our community-based partners out there, our contract providers that we do have housing, and expanding and utilizing these beds for individuals, even allowing them to put them out maybe in counties that are not of their last legal residence, but they're a house that I can get them out to now, a location now, until we can transition them to their county. So we've expanded our criteria in this area. We've expanded our ability to do it. But again, it comes down to locations and doing it for the right reasons, but then not only doing it for the right healthcare reasons, making sure we're putting people out and communicating with public health, communicating with the communities that individuals that are coming out, they either have to finish up quarantine periods or isolation periods. If they're isolation and they owe, you know, isolation times because they're COVID positive, we have to address that. I don't know how responsible that is or how it would be received in the community that, you know, corrections is emptying individuals out that are COVID positive. That's a tough one. That is a tough one to communicate to somebody that, is that the right thing to do? I would say that if someone is COVID positive and they're in the institutions, you know, they are receiving the health care, they're being looked after. And once they're done, we're trying to get them out as fast as possible. The early releases, I got to make them finish that COVID positive period, that quarantine time or that isolation time. If they're quarantined and on an early release, we just got to make sure they're getting into a location. But we've had challenges where individuals do not want to test. We have individuals that who don't want to follow up with the healthcare inside, and it makes it challenging. And it would appear, you know, corrections, you're not releasing this person. But, you know, luckily with the help of groups to go communicate, inmate advisory councils have been briefed by healthcare to go talk to people who are refusing to test, and they're getting them to test. So if there's any messaging that you could do, message out there, because there is a small group that just, they don't want to test and they won't test for their reasons. And but we're not, you know, using force on anybody to make them test. This is for the health and welfare of everybody.
I have a question, and this one has come up. Right now, nonviolent, non-sexual people that have serious convictions can be released or are being considered, that are across the state within 6 months of release and in those eight institutions within a year of release. My question to you is this, and this is not only mine, but many people have sent this question in terms of life prisoners that have done an abundance of rehabilitative work, are leaders and peace on the yard, have addressed all of their issues while incarcerated, and like literally as a former lifer, knowing what it takes just to be found suitable, is there a way to expedite their hearings? But more importantly, can this group of people start being considered, especially when we take a look at the recidivism rate for lifers to be included? The first year for recidivism for lifers is 0.3. The second year or the third year is 2.3. And for juvenile lifers, it's 1.1%. Those are the lowest recidivism rates in any state across the country in any group of people. But because most, if not all, of their convictions are violent, they're not included in this group of people. However, this group of people would actually enhance public safety and would be the safest group to at least be considered into being included into that group. Is that being considered? How can we as advocates in the public help lift this group of people up, like the Hope and Redemption team, a bunch of former lifers and so many others that you know, that thousands and thousands that have been released and have done nothing but give back to our communities and make our state better.
So yeah, I agree with you, Sam. I know that these lifers, you know, the day of the lifer never getting a date, which was coming into this system in the 90s and even into the 2000s, if you were a lifer, the dates just weren't there. Now, the grant rates right now are at 34% grant rates. BPH has expedited and prioritized to make sure that individuals are getting board hearings to the point where they've expanded video hearings, so they did not stop. But I tell you, the authority granted under Government Code 8658, you know, it comes with a lot of responsibility. It does. And I have to make sure that I am making decisions that in the end aren't going to have future concerns, whether the appearance of, you know, the secretary is usurping or going beyond what the court has mandated. And I'm jumping into the lane of the sentencing courts. There's the 1170D project that I fully and wholly support within CDCR, and I get cases that come up to me, lifers that have shown exemplary behavior, and I refer them to the court with all confidence with my signature on it. And these aren't files that come up and I just, you know, just look at them briefly. I read them in detail. And when I put my signature on one, I wholly support it. And it goes to the court. Right now, the courts, they're backed up even with these cases. So we've had these discussions on what we do with lifers. I've had these discussions with the governor's office about that, the governor's legal, on what we do with lifers. And we have to do it in a way to where we are number one, recognizing and appreciating that these lifers are, you know, are the stabilizing factor on many of our yards. But at the same time, if I, as a secretary, just start utilizing authorities given to me that fall more into the governor's arena or into the court's arena, my fear is I would be setting something up to where the authority that is given to the secretary can be called into question by people who don't agree with it. We are focusing on lifers. We want to do them. And I recognize that their recidivism rates are low. I know some of their risk factors are low. I know the comprehensive psychological evaluations they go through the board. They're almost a gold standard. But again, I'm very mindful of the authority that's given to the secretary. And it's like that old saying, with much responsibility that you're given, you got to use it wisely. So they will be seen. There are lifers in these cohorts that we're talking about, but they will be reviewed. But to say that I can do it like the 6 month or the 60 day ones, I just can't.
Thank you. Understood. Let me ask about Prop 57. Can CDCR, are there mechanisms within Prop 57 to expedite people being released? And just so everyone knows too, like there are initiatives to roll back Prop 57. So for all of our listeners, understand that Prop 57 is under attack. It's on the ballot. It's called the Cooper Initiative. Please take a moment to review to take a look at Prop 57, as it's one of the mechanisms that can be used as far as additional credits earned, and specifically to that for many of the rehabilitative groups or groups that provide rehabilitative programs, RAC credits cannot be earned right now, even though we're sending in homework assignments. So is there a way to get that back online to also increase the amount of time that's being earned and taking into consideration that serious rehabilitative work is being done inside cells, even during COVID time?
So I totally recognize that the RACs have not been earned and are not being earned since March. And that's why the 12 weeks were granted in the memorandum that I put out under the authority of Prop 57. But we have to remember, under the authority of Prop 57, there were certain groups that were excluded from earning credits even under Prop 57, which was condemned into the LWOPs. So I'm using that same authority. I'm not trying to bend or expand that authority. I'm trying to use that authority in 57, recognizing that these 12 weeks were given to individuals for not earning, for not participating in classes, for not mastering a skill that they may have learned in some of these classes, or not even being able to exercise some of the skills that they learned in these great classes. It's really because of their behavior. And I believe because of the positive behavior that we are seeing during COVID, it's as a result of the RAC programs, of the milestone programs, of the gains of Prop 57. So, the question of how do we get these RACs going again? How are we able to facilitate them? I think it almost dovetails into the video, the video visiting or the video communication piece. How do we get people safely in a room together within 6 feet and to provide all the COVID precautions? How do we do that? I'm paying very close attention to the school situation that's happening in our state and around the country on that decision, because I may be looking at some of the best practices on how to get people in a group setting again. The classroom of 30, I don't know if it's going to be 30 anymore. Is it going to be 15? Does that mean I have less education opportunities just because the class got smaller? And I believe the answer should be no, but then how do I plus it up? I've got to have an electronic solution. So getting back to RAC, I know the Director of Corrections, Connie Gibson, she is looking at how this can be done. If it is a matter of, if it's correspondence, if it's other means other than people actually coming in, then, that can be done. Before we had face-to-face college at every one of our prisons, that's how people got a degree, through correspondence. It's not anything new to us, but then it would come down to how could I demonstrate that the individual that's receiving these credits actually did something? So, if I can find a way to thread that needle to show that they're actually participating, and I would say, people would say, well, then they can just return their documents through the through the prison, and the prison can get it to the facilitator, and then they can get the credit. Maybe that's what we'll do. But again, I want it to be something that I can all confidence stand up in front of anybody and say, we're doing this because people are actually doing something. They're actually participating in something and earning these credits as established in 57.
Thank you for that answer. We're getting close to closing time. So I'd like to ask any closing thoughts for our concerned community. There are a lot of people, and I get messages both inside and out. Being a former lifer, it's scary. It's really, really scary, especially without being able to communicate. Are there some action steps you can share with us that we can do to move forward? Tablets, we would definitely be reaching out to our philanthropic partners throughout the community. But more importantly, understanding that a lot of this has implications that affect people that have been affected by crime. Your thoughts, your closing thoughts, and anything you'd like to share with our community that's listening right now?
So I would say, taking the position of secretary, going on 2 years since I began acting, and I took over from the prior secretary. This is not the secretary position that I wanted to be doing right now, facing COVID and dealing with COVID issues. And I only say that because there was a statement made in a hearing not that long ago that said that I personally don't care, or the staff don't care about the individuals that are incarcerated. And I couldn't disagree with that more. I know there's a lot of concerns out there, and I know that there are people concerned about their loved ones. I know that personally because I do have loved ones, personal loved ones, that are in the system that I run. And I get calls, and I get the emails, and I hear. And that's why, since COVID took over, and we've been in COVID mode since March, there's no such thing as a day off. There's no such thing as a vacation. There's no such thing. We have been in COVID mode since the beginning, since March. We are on this on a daily basis. The care that's being put in by the healthcare staff to the point to where they're exhausted, the care that the custody staff and the wardens have over their prisons. The COVID rate for employees is 795. Where do they get it? They get it in the community, they get it inside. Who knows where? I'm not trying to point the finger on how they got it, but what I am looking at is that we've had over 561 return to work. We've had individuals that get COVID, and they're trying to come back early because they're saying, we want to get back in and help. So if I want to leave with anything, we care. We do care. And if decisions don't go the way that some like, that's not an indication that we don't care. That just is an indication that the issue is so complex. It's not a right now issue. Maybe it's, you know, a next week issue, or maybe it's a legislative issue that has to go into place. But I'll tell you, this is not the system I wanted to be running in 2020. I wanted to be running a system, the things that I've seen in other countries on my trips to other states, some of the best practice, the practice of normalization and humanization of the individuals in this system, and to allow them proper return to a community and to put a human face on them. You know, with that, as far as, you know, how we're going to continue to address this, we just have to recognize that this is a big, big system. And it's not a big system because CDCR created the system. It's a big system because of the laws that were passed by either the legislature or the citizens of California that put people in prison. And not only put people in prison, but then add enhancements to those sentences, which increase their sentence. There's only so much at my disposal to address those issues other than the 1170D process. And to advocate and put a human face on individuals and say, yes, they are ready to return. And that's why, you know, I wholeheartedly support 1170, wholeheartedly support coming in and participating in a group like this and working with groups like yours and working with people like you, Sam. We don't always agree. We don't. And you've made it very clear, but I respect you enough that I do think about, you know, the things that are being said and the things that advocates say. Doesn't mean that, you know, there should be, you know, ill feelings. It just means that that's where more conversations need to be had. I'm looking forward to the day to where, you know, the COVID numbers drop and we can get back to some semblance of normalcy in our prisons, and we can pick up the good work that's been had in the past, and we can continue on it. You know, I care about the system, not only because I believe that
You know, the good Lord has put me here for a reason, but also because I got loved ones in the system and I got loved ones that work for the system. And I believe we do good work.
Thank you, Secretary Diaz, for joining us today. Thank you for sharing your answers. We hope we've had abundance of questions, and if possible, maybe we could send some of these questions and you send them back with answers.
I welcome that. Send them.
Absolutely. And we'll post them. So because what we want to do is just create a larger dialogue and as much transparency as we can. We want to push transparency so people know what's going on with their families, but also what people can do to make sure that their family members are safe, that we can get video visiting that doesn't, and when COVID is over, video visiting is just something that's emergency standby or something that's used as a supplement but not a replacement. And so the hope for this conversation was just to create a dialogue so that people would get information that they needed so they'll know what's going on. Again, thank you. We've received so many, like our emails and our Facebook page were inundated with so many things. We will be reaching out. We would like our audience. One question that was in the chat box or in the Q&A was, if people want to donate, for instance, we've gotten a number of letters that sometimes soap or masks are not available. We want to donate. We want to make sure that it's going into the institutions. Which steps can we take to do that?
So, because we're such a large system and there's no one clearinghouse to where something comes in, I think I'll have Chrissy from External Affairs reach out to you, Sam, and to give you the best way to do it. I mean, I would just say contact the institutions, but
no way.
35 prisons. So I think that's the best way to put the people that are asking where to give, what's the best way to contact.
Thank you again, Secretary Diaz. And this was ARC's Fireside Chat for this Friday. Next Friday, we will be talking to family members who have lost loved ones to violent crime but want to see people released that are advocates for people that are incarcerated that have, such as myself, that was once incarcerated and committed a horrible crime. So we'll be talking to people who have had family members lost to violent crime. And hopefully maybe in the future, not too long from now, as we figure out more ways to help communication and decrease the population inside the Department of Corrections, we can have another Fireside Chat, Secretary Diaz.
Thank you. Thank you, Sam. Take care.
Thank you, everyone, for joining. Have a great day. Stay blessed.